here we are, all together as we sing our song. Joyfully, here we are, all together as we pray, we'll always be.
If you want to stand, you can. The words are in your bulletin.
Is really tough to get my required 250 steps. So this works well. Method to our madness, or whatever. Well, welcome to Unity by the Sea. It's so nice to have you all here today. We have people from Portland. Thank you so very much. Besides you, Portland, people back there from Portland.
Yay, Portland.
Yay, Portland. Okay. We have Newport.
Yay, Newport.
We have Glen Eden Beach.
Yay, Glen Eden Beach.
We have McMinnville.
Minnville.
We have Beaver.
Beaver. I know where that is.
Yes.
Otis.
How about Lincoln? Yeah. Otis. What about Lincoln City?
Yay.
Yay. We're kind of spread out today, have you noticed? Yeah, good show. Very good show. And do you like the weather?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Isn't it like this all the time here?
Obviously, you aren't here full time. We could have also said Salem, because she's Salem as well.
Part time.
Part time. So anyway, welcome. So nice to see all of you here today. Very, very interesting day. It's going to be special things to celebrate, as always. And one of the things that I would like to announce right up front in the very beginning, we are having a board meeting today after service, and today is the day that we are welcoming Reverend Jean Celia onto the board at Unity by the Sea. Didn't know I was going to do that, did you?
No.
Gotcha, didn't I?
Yeah.
Okay. So at this point, I'm going to light the Christ candle. And as we mention each week when this is being done, the reason for this is strictly for it to be a visual reminder so that we have this to look at, to be reminded of the idea that this is a visual of the Christ light that is within all of us at all points in time. Not only us, but everybody else as well. And that's how we're connected. That's the part that is all over the place for everybody. So that's the reason for that one. And now I'm going to ask Jean if she will please do the opening prayer. Did you lose your place?
No, I wasn't paying attention. I was thinking about the Christ light that I just see it in each of us just glowing hugely. And yeah, great. Good morning, everyone. Before I begin, I would just like to say this is birthday Sunday.
Yes.
Happy birthday to Terry, who is downstairs because she brought goodies for us in honor of her birthday. And it's also Linda's birthday, and she's not with us this morning.
And Joe, where do you go?
Okay, and Joe. And we're going to sing happy birthday at the very end, so everybody who has a birthday in April will be honored. And you, oh my gosh, and Cheryl, wow, April's a good month. Yes, indeed. Although so's August. Are you in April too, John?
Yeah.
You say you're in every month. Really?
Oh, yeah.
he does not get older every month.
Oh.
He just celebrates a birthday every month. So that
okay.
He can be sure and get all of the cake and pies.
Oh, good.
And now you're catching on.
And birthday cupcakes that were brought by our birthday girl.
We're our birthday together.
Is it your birthday too?
You have a birthday. When's yours?
21st.
Oh!
Okay, is there anyone whose birthday is not in April? Thank goodness. So, a big one?
Oh, it can't be that big. Yeah, right. Yeah.
You will be.
You're still a kid.
You're still a baby, huh?
You're still a baby.
I'm not going to say from up here how old. I know, right? Yeah. Yeah, well, we won't talk about that.
State of mind. Yeah, state of mind.
I don't look in the mirror very often. That's right.
Okay, let's just pray. How about that? That's always a solution, right? Take a deep breath, and we are so grateful to be here on this glorious day and in good, high, holy company in this sanctuary of peace, celebrating the first Sunday in April, allowing the Christ light in us to be fed and nurtured and glow through each of us as we raise the consciousness of the world. For we are the light. We are the light, and I am so grateful each of us is here this morning, and I say thank you, God, and so it is. Amen. And now we have the daily word.
No. Oh, well, it'd be nice if people told me.
There, I wrote it down.
Don't write it down if you're not going to go by it.
See.
Well, they come in and change everything and don't tell me.
Oh, you should expect the change that. Fairies, huh? Okay.
That's what we are.
Good morning. Today's daily word says, I am a miracle of life. Incredible occurrences are recognized as miracles. I'm reading the wrong one, so no, just scratch that. Now we're going to move on to triumph. Okay. I did this at my wedding, too. Where was that ring? Oh, gosh, it's in the study. Okay. I got it. I know there's. It actually has the date. Thank you.
And it's big print. The one up here is big.
I have no excuses. Okay. Spirit provides all that I need for triumphant living. There are times when I have pulled through adversity, loss, or trauma. Some of these victories were not easy because I resisted at first. Other times I may have struggled with feeling lost and alone, but my faith assured me that God and I are one. God is always with me. This knowledge strengthens my faith, wisdom, and peace of mind, the spiritual tools I need as I move forward in faith and courage. I willingly meet all events of my life by viewing them as growth opportunities. The triumphant pattern of my life is woven. Through prayer, I follow divine inner guidance, tapping into my creativity and engaging in the effective joy of collaboration. Spirit provides all that I need for triumphant living. And the scripture today is 2 Corinthians 2:14. But thanks be to God, who in Christ always leads us in triumphal procession.
I was trying to make. Did you see the sumo wrestlers down there?
Yeah,
they're little. Did I fall for it?
little small sumo wrestler.
They're leaving.
Hi, gang. Nice day, huh? Next week, Reverend Lorena Smith will be with us. Her topic is the place of grace. Even though next Sunday will be Palm Sunday, we're planning on celebrating our special Unity by the Sea Good Friday celebration, which we normally hold on Easter Sunday, which is we'll have nice hot crust buns following the service next week. Hot crust buns that come from the food cake, they come from the fruit cake food group, because when I make hot crust buns, I mean, these are special. You can put these suckers on your kitchen counter, and a year from now, they'll still be great. They never rot. They're perfect. So join us next week. We're going to try to do the hot crust bun thing. Joining Lorena next week is John Meyer doing the music. There's a flyer in your bulletin about our ever-exciting annual garage sale, or parking lot sale, if you prefer. This year, the countywide sale is April 21st through the 23rd. We'll hold our sale on Friday and Saturday only, the 21st and 22nd. So bring your stuff next Sunday or the one after that, or call during the week. We'll make arrangements to let you bring it in, whatever. Bring all of your treasures that you don't need anymore, so we can have a big sale. Michael is doing the, is running the show. If you can help him on those 2 days, Friday and Saturday, get with him, because he needs, Michael needs all the help he can get. All right, so bring your stuff. Easter Sunday's quickly heading our way. April 16th, actually. That seems early to me. Is it early or is it just me? I think it's early. Sandra Combs will be here to do the service. After the service, we're going to adjourn to a food place. Now, it's still up for grabs as to what food place. We've been throwing out a few ideas, such as Vivian's or Sambo's or a couple others, Seafood Grill. So let us know your ideas. We're going to go someplace and have something to eat for lunch after services on Easter Sunday. Okay? That's all I got.
And if you could give us an idea, like next Sunday, who would like to be joining and getting together on Easter Sunday to go out, because it would probably be nice if we tried to make reservations, you know, because it could be kind of a busy time. And from what John was saying about the idea of the hot cross bun lasting, he did that 1 year. He took one of them and put it on his desk. And the strangest thing happened. It was there, it lasted all the way through the year, and it got very, very hard, to say the least. It never spoiled. It never did. It just turned into a rock. But it disappeared. Because the next year, he was going to bring it in to talk about it. And it was gone. And we never did find out what happened to it.
It arose.
Huh? It arose. Could be, because it was certainly ended up gone. There's no doubt about that. Okay, time that I remind you of our prayer box. And you'll find your prayer requests in the back of the pews. And it's something that is really a very nice practice. If you've never done it or if you are familiar with it, it's really terrific because for me personally, and I think as well as some other people as well, by filling that piece of paper out and putting it in the prayer box or in the bowls when they come around or even back in the corner, it's a matter of releasing it. So it's like, okay, now I don't have to be worried about it anymore. I've let go of it, I've let God, and it's taken care of. So it can be very helpful in that way, if that's the way that you can be looking at it. And also we have daily words. Copies of them are on the table to the right of the door out here. If you get it here at church, it's only $3, and they're good for 2 months. This is good for March, which is a little late. And then there's April. And so we have those out there as well. And, oh, that's cute. I didn't get my affirmations taped up here. Thank you. If you'll take your affirmations, please, out of your bulletin. We will do the one for the church first, which is the one that has the flowers on it and the butterfly. So please affirm this with me. With each new day, the life, light, and love of God is reborn within unity by the sea. We joyously express God in all that we do and all that we do. And then for ourselves. With each new day, the life, light, and love of God is reborn within me. I joyously express God in all that I am and all that I do. And so it is. Thank you. And I believe now Susan's going to be doing some music.
I'd like to speak about that first.
Okay. Oh, just a minute, please.
Go I want to speak first. We just work here. Thank you.
Many. Yeah. We let you think that, Judy. Many years ago, when I first started going to the Religious Science Church in Portland, one Easter, this is more than 30 years ago, more than 35 years ago, I heard, that's, I'm stopping there, I'm not going any farther. I heard Mary Lynn Bull Brown sing a song on Easter, and it so moved me that every Easter, it is my mandatory, must-do song, just like every Christmas, we do Mary Did You Know, which is my very favorite Christmas song. And so we are so blessed today that Susan will be singing this Easter, what I think of as the Easter song for us. Thank you so much. Thank you. I didn't steer you wrong, did I? Susan. Good thing Linda's not here today. She'd say, every time you're here, Jean, I cry. I don't do it on purpose. Living Lent. Y'all know that that's the season we're in right now, is Lent. In Revelation 21:5, John writes, behold, the other John, not this John, a different John, right? Okay. Although you write really well, but this was St. John wrote, behold, I make all things new. Behold, I make all things new. The new Jerusalem, the newness and the wholeness of life. That's the promise that I hang on to, especially in Lent. Behold, I make all things new. And of course, we know we're in the throes of Lent. Palm Sunday is next Sunday, and we're going to do something a little different with the cross buns. And following that on April 16 is Sunday, is Easter. And this High Holy Week between Palm Sunday and Easter in Christianity is the time where we celebrate that death is dissolved and transformed into the resurrection of Christ. Death itself is dissolved and transformed. When we live Lent, when it lives in our hearts and we allow it to pour forth in our lives, when we are fully immersed in the holy and the sacred living of the Easter season, we are transformed at the very core of our being. Transformed. When I was a child, you know, I was raised Catholic, and so when I was quite younger, I really didn't like Lent because it meant you have to give something up. You know, who wants to give something up? It's like, even now, no. And yet Easter I loved because I would always get a new hat. Love new hats. I get to be the pulpit assistant on Easter, and I'm going to wear an Easter bonnet. And I invite everyone who's here for Easter to wear an Easter bonnet too. So that's what I liked. Not the Lent part, like, giving stuff up. But the Easter part of getting something new, because voluntary sacrifice does not always thrill us. And that's not just true for kids, it's true for all of us. And yet the notion of sacrifice is letting go of something that you value. And it's a challenge. It's a challenge for us as humans to do that. This year, for Lent, I gave up sweet things. I love sweet things. And so that is a challenge for me. Because when we commit to releasing some deep-seated habit, like that is for me, or fear, or thought, what happens is, whatever that is that we are willing to release comes to the forefront and says, hey, are you sure? This is not so easy, you know. And so what happens is that our commitment, our resolution to not taking that donut, to not taking that whatever it is at work when people walk around with a fresh box of donuts and I can smell them, what happens is we retreat. And the old and the tried and the true, oh, I'll just have one donut, right? When it becomes difficult, we go back to the old habits. What do they say? Under stress, we regress. When it's hard. G.K. Chesterton wrote, the Christian ideal, that is, living the light of love and truth, the Christian ideal has not been tried and found wanting. It's not that there's anything wrong with it. It's that it has been found difficult and left untried. Not so easy to sacrifice things. Not so easy for me to totally let go of sweet things. Or one of my coworkers has let go of swearing. So 25 cents goes in the box every time she swears. There's less than a dollar in there because she is more conscious of it. Right? But that's not so easy for her. That's why it's a sacrifice. It has been found difficult and left untried. Because at some point we say, oh man, this is just too hard. Living Lent fully is difficult and too often left untried for those 40 days and 6 Sundays. I am in being a former Catholic. I don't think you can ever be a former. You just are. I went to Mass at noon to a church close to my work on Ash Wednesday. You know, they do the from ashes you were made into ashes you shall return, which reminds us of the transient nature of our precious life, right? It's not permanent. Nothing is permanent but God. That's all. And so I came back to work because I went to the noon Mass, and my friend who gave up the swearing, she came over and she said, oh, you went to Mass? And I said, yes, I did. And she said, you know, I've been reading about that. She said, I'm not going till tonight, and I'm pretty excited to see what kind of mark I'm going to get. And I said, well, don't you always get a cross? And she said, well, it kind of starts out that way, but I've been reading online that sometimes the cross looks like a Rorschach, or sometimes it looks like a dot, but yours looks like it's just low on toner. I said, really? She said, yeah, it starts out really strong and then gets light, starts out strong and gets light. You're just, it was just low on toner. And I thought, oh my gosh, what a fun way to think of Ash Wednesday. I never quite thought of it that way. Anyway, that was kind of fun. Ash Wednesday, of course, marks the beginning of Lent. And it's the time that we are called to more fully appreciate the death and the resurrection of Christ through self-examination, contemplation, prayer, fasting or sacrifice, and repentance. That fasting part, that sacrifice part, giving up something of value, be it sweet things or swearing or whatever it is for you, Lent is about contemplation and repentance. And I know when I was growing up, repentance was a fiery thing, to repent. When actually the act of repenting is deeply and fully releasing regret. Oh geez, why did I do that? Oh geez, I was so silly. Let it go. It's done. Fully releasing regret, remorse, habits, like reaching for the donut, and fear. And in its place, you know, just letting go of something leaves a void, a space. And when we intentionally fill that space is when we are blessed with the conscious and whole newness. And so when we begin to repent, when we begin to let go of remorse and fear and sweet things, what we get to do is consciously, literally, look to the light. Because as Emma Curtis Hopkins says, when you look to the light, when you look to God, when you look to truth, when you begin to breathe wholeness, shadows fall behind you. All of your triggers, all of your doubts fall behind you. All of those temptations, when you are focused on the light, when you are focused on God. Lent is a time that allows us to let go of the old so that we can look to God. And that salvation, that grace, begins to fill us. The affirmation last month, I just love that for those of you who were with us last month. The light of God lives in the quiet of my heart, and I am at peace. That's how we turn to God. We keep repeating things like that until we actually feel it in our hearts. There's a cartoon, you know I love cartoons, and it's Pearls Before Swine. And the little mouse says to the pig is there looking over this wall, cliff. And the little mouse says, "What are you doing?" And he says, "Oh, I'm just enjoying a moment." And the mouse said, "You mean you're not tweeting about it or posting it on Instagram or sharing it on Facebook?" "No, I'm just enjoying the moment." So mouse goes back and says to goat, "Pig has lost his ever-loving mind." Right? It's not okay today to just enjoy the moment. We have to tweet it out. We have to post it on Facebook. We have to let. So we just, it's so unusual for us to just get quiet and enjoy the moment. Lent is a season when we get to reflect and prepare for Christmas, for the resurrection, when we have the opportunity to replicate Jesus' sacrifice and his withdrawal into the desert for 40 days, hence the 40 days of Lent, plus 6 Sundays, I have to throw that in there. St. Paul directs us to put on the mind of Christ in 1 Corinthians. That is, think, see, speak, act as love. Put on the mind of Christ. And so with that intention in my heart, I went to church on Ash Wednesday. And there's a question that came to me while I was at church. It's very interesting. Sometimes that just happens. And I have kind of been wrestling with it ever since. And I'm going to share that with you today. And maybe you can wrestle a while too. It just floated into my awareness. And the question is, do you more fully, more closely, relate to the crucified Jesus or the risen Christ? Do you more fully align yourself with the crucified Jesus or the risen Christ? In my younger Catholic years, you know, in every church, I've only ever seen the cross with Jesus on it. And as I got a little older, I understood how kind of morose that is. It's like, really? Oh my gosh! It doesn't feel very joyous or loving, really. And yet, to me, that was what church was about. And so the very first time Mike and I went to Mexico, one thing, you know, we like to walk through the little towns, and we were walking through a little town, and there was a little chapel, and I said, "Oh, let's go in, let's see what it's like." And we since go into every little chapel that we see because everyone's a little different. I walked into that chapel, and there was not a cross with the crucified Jesus. There was no cross. At the front of that church, there was simply the resurrected Christ. What an awakening that was for me. It was like all these years, I've been taught to identify with the crucified Jesus, and there's a different way to do it. I can identify with the risen Christ. Right there it is in a church. It must be okay. It must be okay to be happy. And to focus more on the resurrection than the crucifixion, right? Oh my gosh, that really was an awakening for me. So I ask you that this morning. Is it more about the crucifixion or the resurrection? This morning, we were letting the dogs out at home here, and Mike said, "Oh, the sun is out? There's no clouds in the sky, and yet it's raining." It was. And I said, oh, quick, let's look for the rainbow. There's got to be a rainbow someplace, right? Do we more closely align with, oh, it's raining, or where's the rainbow? You know? I mean, think about that today. It's kind of profound. On Thursday, April 13, a week from this Thursday, remember that's Holy Week, High Holy Week between Palm Sunday and Easter Sunday. On April 13, we celebrate Maundy Thursday, which is a high holy day for the Catholics. You have to go to church. That honors the Last Supper of Jesus with his disciples. The Last Supper on Thursday. On Friday, which is April 14th, and I will say we were talking about birthdays earlier. That's my sister's birthday. She passed away a little more than 4 years ago, and of course we celebrate her birthday all the time. So her birthday's on Good Friday. Happy birthday, Karen. That is when, of course, Jesus was crucified on the cross. And remember, in this world of duality, no saint without a sinner, no good without the bad, in this world of duality, there is no death without a resurrection. It's black and white, yin and yang. Without letting go of the old, there is no new. Behold, I make all things new. What a promise. What a glory. It's the inevitable promise. And it always happens when we are willing to sacrifice, to let go. You know, sacrifice doesn't always have to be painful. It's simply letting go of what no longer serves us. And when we allow ourselves to simply be, just like Pig did, you don't have to tweet out everything. You don't have to call people. You don't have to text all the time. Just be. Disconnect, become untethered, and just be. So my question this morning, right now, this day, do you relate more fully to the crucified Jesus or the resurrected Christ? That's our question. Behold, I make all things new. I'd like to end with a quote from spiritual teacher Carl McColeman, who wrote, God is in us because we are in Christ. As members of the mystical body, Christians actually partake in the divine nature of God. We do not merely watch the dance, we dance the dance. We join hands with Christ, and the Spirit flows through us and between us, and our feet move always in the loving embrace of the Father. In that we are members of the mystical body of Christ, we see the joyful love of God through the eyes of Jesus the Son. And with every breath, we breathe the Holy Spirit. That is living Lent. And I invite you to be willing to do that and to more closely align yourself with the risen Christ. And as we move into our time of meditation, I'd like us to chant together. Susan will lead us. Our words, our chants are really powerful, especially when we add movements. And so the words to this are very simple, and we do have hand motions with them. You might not want to go like that if you're sitting close to someone. The words are, Christ is in me, I am in Christ. So it's right, see, Christ is in me, I am in Christ. We take it in, Christ is in me, and we let it out, I am in Christ. We don't hold it in, we share our Christ light with everyone. So let's chant that for just a little bit, and then we'll go into our meditation.
Christ is in me, I am in Christ. 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 Christ is in me, I am in Christ.
Last time.
Christ is in me, I am in Christ.
For truly Christ is in me and I am in Christ, where there is no separation. Let's just breathe deeply, letting go of any doubts that we have this morning, any fears. Willing to truly breathe the Holy Spirit with every breath we take. Letting go of all as we look to the light. And allowing that light that always lives in us to fill us more fully. Behold, I make all things new. And we breathe that newness. For I know there is one presence, one essence, and that is God. That is the Christ. That is love. That is that light that lives in us, in each of us. And beside it, there is none other. There is only that one living presence that flows in, through, and as each of us. And I speak my word for every person present, knowing that that Holy Spirit is, in fact, the very truth of our being. That it is that Holy Spirit that makes all things new, as we allow it to do so. And I say thank you, God, as I release my words into law, knowing, absolutely knowing, they are already true, here and now, and so it is. Amen. And when you feel like opening your eyes, you can gently do that. And I do want to acknowledge that it was Reverend Suze Ogden who wrote that chant. And if you were here with us for either Susan's ordination or the Sunday following, Reverend Suze was here. She's a delight, just a total delight. And now, just in case you have an offering, a blessing, an offering to share with and support that which supports you. Remember that flow of love, that flow of Holy Spirit. Would you just gently hold that in your hand or close to your heart? And repeat with me the blessing that's in your bulletin. Divine love through me blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. Amen, and thank you, God. And now I think we have some very special music from both Mike and Susan. Oh, you want me to bless the offering first? Okay.
They make me do.
They make you do that? Really? Oh my gosh.
I tried to not do it.
Okay.
And I say thank you, God, for these gifts. And I know every gift freely given returns to the giver, pressed down, shaken together, multiplied, and overflowing in the experience. As these gifts go forth to support the nurturing of the Christ light around the globe. And I say thank you, God. Amen.
And so should we stand for this, or do you think we should sit, or, I don't know, with the tambourine?
As spirit moves you.
As spirit moves you. Okay.
You can even sing along, I'll bet.
Whoop, okay.
You just started off of your
tough act to follow. I know you're up to it.
I won't sing it.
Although you could.
Please join me in singing the, reading our statement for peace. It's in your bulletin and a little thing like that. Unity stands for peace in the presence of conflict, for love in the presence of hatred, for forgiveness in the presence of injury. Unity honors the many names for God, the many paths to God, the many ways to worship God, for there is only one presence and one presence of God, and that God loves each of us equally. It is therefore the position of unity to urge all nations, their leaders and their people, to turn to whatever the name in these challenging times, and to pursue peace, not war, for this is what honors the God of all our faith traditions. Unity stands for peace in our lifetime. The wolf shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the kid, and the calf and the lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. And they shall not hurt or destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord. I will not be the part of the killing of any child, no matter how lofty the reason, not my neighbor's child, not my enemy's child, not by bomb, not by bullet, not by looking the other way. I will be the power that is peace. Thank you.
And while we're all standing, let's get together and for our closing circle. I will remind everyone, if you would like to volunteer and be part of this fun and frivolity, on a Sunday, you can sign up to be a platform assistant, the camera person, a greeter, to bring goodies, to read the daily word. So many opportunities to be part of the celebration here in a different way. So just encourage you to do that. It's in the table in the foyer. And it's orange, right? There we go. Orange.
Orange, thank you. So for everyone whose birthday is this month, Terry and John and Cheryl and I forget who else. Kate, John, Kate, and Linda, who's not with us today, and the rest of you guys just were born in the wrong month. Clearly. We'll sing
happy. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
On in the world, I just invite you in this moment of living Lent and stepping into the quiet of your heart, that if there is something or someone open to prayer or healing, I just invite you to say that here, verbally into the circle.
Thank you.
and the God that surrounds us, the love of God enthralls us, the power of God protects us, and the presence of God watches over us wherever we are.